This is Defenders TV Podcast, episode 73, looking at Doctor Strange, the Sorcerer Supreme, the 2007 animated film from Marvel. Welcome back, Defenders. This is Defenders TV Podcast, episode 73, looking at Doctor Strange, the Sorcerer Supreme, the 2007 animated film from Marvel Animated Studios. I'm your host, Chris. They let me back in the pilot seat just for this one episode. I know probably by the end of this recording, I'm not going to be in it. So let's see how long it takes until Derek kind of wrestles the steering wheel from me.
That's not true. That's not going to happen.
Well, like Indiana Jones, I'm wrestling for the inflatable dinghy.
I'm one of your hosts, Chris.
I'm one of your other hosts, Derek.
And I'm one of your other hosts, John.
I suppose we could just keep going, other.
Hello, everyone. Good to be back. This is the third podcast on our Doctor Strange Summer of Strange series. We're edging closer towards October, where all paths in the Marvel Universe are leading to at the moment, in comic form, in teaser trailer release form, in reaction videos to teaser trailers, and obviously with Netflix coming in as well, The Defenders, which... Okay, kind of leads to Doctor Strange.
Partially, yes. And you say October, just to point out for our American listeners or our Canadian listeners, North American listeners, I suppose, Doctor Strange does come out in Europe a couple of days before it comes out in the US. It comes out in October 26th, 27th, I think so,
yeah. It's continuing in the good tradition of the Marvel release. I think it's basically because Europeans tend to bootleg films more than the Americans.
Apparently that is true.
We're really bad.
Yes, yeah. But we don't usually get the extra tag that goes on an American movie, American Marvel movies. But that's okay, we don't mind, as long as we get the full actual film beforehand.
No, excuse me, hold on, I'm putting in here. I want those tags. We didn't get the shawarma scene in Avengers.
Thank God.
No! That was a classic Marvel, John Favreau, Josh Whedon style.
That's John's least favourite tag on a Marvel film.
Yeah, I prefer my tags to actually kind of kick you off into the upcoming film next. It really gets you salivating for that film in the same way that the opening of a Bond really gets you excited for then the big musical intro and the rest of the film. You know, really kind of a big wham bam.
So speaking of kicking us off and getting us into the podcast, first thing we want to just talk about is we do have our Summer Strange competition going on at the moment. All it is, very simply, it's a prize draw. For anybody who's left a review for us over at iTunes, you can access iTunes for our particular podcast by just going to defenderstvpodcast.com/iTunes, click the reviews button, log in and just leave us a review, and just send us an email to feedback@defenderstvpodcast.com with your name and the country where you live, because we can't unfortunately catch all of the reviews that go up on iTunes. If you send us an email to that after you've done it, you'll be entered into our prize draw. John, what can they win in the prize draw?
Well, you can win. There is the 2-issue prelude comic for Doctor Strange, the upcoming movie. There's also a vinyl pop Doctor Strange figurine. There is also a new era Doctor Strange baseball cap as well.
Yes, with the seal of Ashanti on the
seal
front.
Of Ashanti, very cool. Right on the front. And we've got pictures up on our website, so you can go to DefendersTVPodcast.com/ Doctor Strange competition, I think. It's a post on our website, so just go to that. You can get further details and you can see a picture of the lovely prizes so far that we will be adding to. But in addition to the cap, there is also then an electronic downloadable version of the current Doctor Strange comic series, Way of the Weird, as well. So at the moment, that's what's in the prize pack. For the prize draw, prizes will build and be added to the prize draw up to the 30th of September, when the winner will be drawn out of a hat on our first podcast review of Luke Cage.
Yes, or some similar receptacle. I'm not sure whether we'll have a hat to put them into, but maybe a baseball cap, possibly.
Absolutely.
But yes, definitely want to reiterate, because basically all of the emails that we've gotten in telling us that they've done reviews have all mentioned the Doctor Strange pop. Everybody seems to want this pop. But all you need to do is just pop us a review on iTunes and you'll be entered into the draw. We got a few reviews so far.
Yeah, absolutely.
And just want to make sure that people do email us, because unfortunately it is difficult to catch some of the reviews that are happening in some other countries outside of Ireland and the UK. So if you do email us, you'll definitely be entered into that. And we're really looking forward to giving back to our listeners who review us, because it does help other people find the podcast as they're looking for shows that cover Doctor Strange, Luke Cage, The Defenders, Daredevil, Jessica Jones. Ours will pop up a little bit quicker for them if we get a couple more.
And The Punisher. Don't forget about The Punisher.
Oh, nobody could forget about The Punisher. We will be doing The Punisher, definitely.
Definitely. And just also to say on the competition, the reason for the email is that, you know, we need to be able to contact whoever is pulled out of the hat. So if we don't have any contact details, obviously we won't be able to get in touch with the winner. Also, it's in case we miss a review, maybe in a country that we don't regularly look at with regards to reviews.
Okay, gents. Well, that's enough about the competition. And don't forget, Defenders, if you're going to enter, as we've literally now said about 17 times, don't forget to send us an email. But more importantly...
Mm-hmm. I know Chris is going to enter because I know you want that cap and the pop.
Like, this is so fair. They bought it for the competition and we have these prizes. I can't take them. It's not fair. I thought this was the perk of the job, but apparently not. You get my perks.
We did kind of get a perk. Like, I bought myself a Doctor Strange hat.
Yeah, great. Yay.
And I got an Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. hat, too.
Yeah, and I don't have a Spider-Man hat.
Sorry.
Or Spider-Gwen.
I didn't see Spider-Man, actually.
I'll have to have a look. So, boys, before we get into the main spoilerific conversations about Doctor Strange, the Sorcerer Supreme 2007 animated film, I have one question for you. What the hell is Thor and Loki going to be doing in going to the Sanctum Sanctorum?
Very true, Chris. Yes, some set photos came out this week from the new Thor Ragnarok film. And what we did see on there is a piece of paper held in the hands of Thor with a very noticeable address on there, John.
I know. 177A Bleecker Street.
That's right, yes. The address.
The Sanctum Sanctorum.
Sanctum Sanctorum, yeah.
Yeah, really good. I mean, like, until I kind of fully read the article attached to the pictures, I was kind of thinking maybe this was... a tag at the end of the Doctor Strange movie suggesting he was going to be in Thor Ragnarok. The thing I am absolutely stoked about with regards to this is that we also in San Diego Comic-Con saw the Armored Hulk gear that was so potentially that Thor Ragnarok sort of might be some kind of spin on World War Hulk or Planet Hulk.
Possibly, yeah.
Possibly, who knows? Or that, you know, Hulk is the bringer of doom and the portents to Ragnarok for Asgard. Mm-hmm. And so that maybe, you know, Hulk and Doctor Strange have a history within the comics with regards to Defenders. Within Planet Hulk, World War Hulk, Doctor Strange is there as well as someone who banishes him to another planet.
Mm.
So if, depending on how that story is going to play out, that's just a kind of theory, very, you know, tenuous one at the moment, but something that is starting to like build with different pieces of the jigsaw. I mean, I think after that, the main thing for me is that Doctor Strange is being incorporated into the wider MCU with regards to Thor Ragnarok. You know, we're hearing about the Guardians of the Galaxy being in the first Infinity War film, and now we see Doctor Strange at least having some kind of influence or some part within Thor Ragnarok, and I mean, hopefully within the Infinity Wars.
Absolutely.
As well.
I would absolutely love if Thor was coming to Doctor Strange for his help to put down the most powerful being in the universe at the moment, which is still Hulk, or at least the most powerful being on Earth. He still hasn't won that battle with Thor yet, so we don't know which one actually would win outright, but we know the Hulk gets stronger and stronger as he gets more and more powerful and more angry. So I'm assuming that Thor does annoy him quite a lot in this film. So
I'm seeing Thumb Wars here, like Hulk versus Thor in Thumb Wars.
Rock, nice. Paper, scissors.
Nice. Hammer. Don't forget the hammer. The only thing is, I actually do think it's a tag. Mm-hmm. I honestly do. Maybe. They've filmed some of these before, these tags, last minute and thrown them in. And it's probably a great way of introducing him fully into the character. You see Thor, mm-hmm. and with the piece of paper, he looks up, he goes into the Sanctum Sanctorum, and there's Benedict Cumberbatch, and he then opens, that scene then opens the beginning of Thor Ragnarok.
Right.
So that's why I'm kind of thinking that they're recording it so late as a way they were hoping to try and get around people who were probably spying the set of Doctor Strange.
Yeah, like, interestingly, the actual photograph came from a pretty well-known writer in Australia. It doesn't seem like somebody that broke on the set. It's somebody that was there for a set visit. So I'm really hopeful it's not a major spoiler. But yeah, you're right. There is definitely a precedence within Marvel Phase 2. In fact, that pretty much every single tag at the end of a film was shot by the director of the next film was pretty much the way they did it. So it wasn't generally done as part of the filming. It was done by the next director with the cast for the
Absolutely,
next movie.
Yeah.
So that is quite possible as well. We will be able to find out in October.
Because all things what, John?
All paths lead to Doctor Strange movie 26th of October.
There you Excellent. Go.
And this podcast will eventually lead to a discussion.
Discussion.
But this is just a long introduction, much like this film.
It will lead to an elated review by me, or I'll be sobbing into my beer.
well, we all
thinking about chucking myself off the first floor window of the house.
I was going to the Sanctum Sanctorum or the bridge from this film. Again, okay, gents, let's kick off because I think our listeners are probably kind of dying to know what we thought about this. Hopefully they watch it too and they have some feedback. So before we get into this, for any of you who are new listeners, the way we cover our podcast, in theory, the structure behind it is that we each take 5 points. We run through them. Typically, there is some overlap because there's only so many points you can take from films but we'll each have a different view or take on it. And, each of us who isn't John, has a deeper understanding of the other side of the Marvel Universe. So John will just kind of go through every character here and love them. But anyway. Gentlemen, do you want to tell the guys where they can find us across the web?
Absolutely, yes. You can download our podcast on any good or evil podcast catcher just by searching Defenders TV Podcast. We've recently joined TuneIn Radio, came online this week, so you can get all of our episodes up there as well. If you're not an Android user, you can also subscribe to us on iTunes at DefendersTVPodcast.com/iTunes or just by searching DefendersTVPodcast.com. You can send us feedback to feedback@DefendersTVPodcast.com. And you can also follow us over on Twitter at DefendersCast or come join our group on Facebook where there's lots of discussions going on about everything Marvel, really. Just search for us at Facebook.com/groups/DefendersTVPodcast. I think with that, it's time to get into our discussion about Doctor Strange, the animated movie, 2007. There's lots of creative people involved in the background. There's an animated movie, so more so than pretty much anything that we've covered before, there's a lot of directors and writers behind it. So quickly, the writer for this, for the screenplay for Doctor Strange, the animated movie, was Greg Johnson. He worked with Craig Kyle on the full script for this production. They also worked together on Planet Hulk, so the other production of this time as well. The voice director for it was Jamie Simone, and the movie itself was directed by three directors, Patrick Archibald, Jay Oliva, and Richard Sebast, all of whom have worked in many, many animated productions right back to the early 80s. So some top quality directors and people involved in the behind the scenes of this movie.
I love Sebast.
I know you do. I know you do. John, do you want to tell us what they gave us in your synopsis for this particular movie?
Sure. New York is under increasing attack from mystical forces and foes that its inhabitants can neither see nor perceive. but a talented yet arrogant neurosurgeon, Dr. Stephen Strange, voiced by Bryce Johnson, begins to see wisps of unknown creatures and also starts to connect, psychically, with the nightmares of an alarming number of child patients admitted to hospitals across New York. Whilst he shrugs these occurrences off, he is involved in a severe car accident, leaving him with crippling injuries to his hands. Searching across the world for a cure to his injured hands, Stephen Strange travels to far-off Tibet to receive physical and spiritual healing from the renowned Ancient One, voiced by Michael Yama. Initially blunt, presumptuous, and sceptical of his healing, Strange is opened up to a world of magical energy by the Ancient One and Wong, played by Paul Nakauchi. As he develops his mystical powers, he is told of his destiny to become Earth's Sorcerer Supreme. However, another student of the mystic arts, Mordo, voiced by Kevin Michael Richardson, becomes jealous of Strange and the attention being placed on him by the Ancient One and Wong, and tries to betray them all to Dormammu, voiced by Jonathan Adams from the Dark Dimension. That's Dormammu, not Jonathan Adams. Who is using the comatose children as a gateway to conquer the Earth. As they face down his evil threat, Stephen Strange uses his new abilities to fight Dormammu, but soon realizes that despite all his immense power, he cannot save everyone.
Excellent. Thanks, John. Again, in this movie, this is a lot deeper into the mythology of Stephen Strange and of Doctor Strange, the masters of the mystic arts. We have got Dormammu in this one. The other realms are mentioned and shown. So lots and lots going on. Well done for distilling it all down into your synopsis.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, yes, as I said in the synopsis, Jonathan Adams is not from the Dark Dimension.
No, he's not.
Dormammu.
Yeah.
Out of all the Marvel animated direct-to-DVD Blu-ray films, for me, this kind of represents the most dynamic, finely produced, and I'll say that with kind of hand on my heart, introduction to the world of Doctor Strange. It's something of a cross between Grey's Anatomy, Batman Begin, and some kind of like RPG action slasher game, kung fu fighting. But it's a fine adaptation of kind of the mythos behind Doctor Strange. And no matter if you're new or you're a lifelong fan like John, you still get some good stuff out of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd agree with that. There's an interesting story that I came across during a bit of research that I was doing for this, where apparently Greg Johnson, the writer of the movie, he based all of the scenes in the hospital on Eeyore, which was a very popular show around the time. And he actually had a surgeon come up to him afterwards and compliment him on how well he designed the staging of the movie. And he had to kind of tell him, well, I actually didn't do any research. I just watched the TV show Eeyore. So there is some influence in there for Eeyore. So that was quite cool. Yeah, overall, similar. I did enjoy it. Overall, there are some marginal things that I'll probably talk about as we go through. A really good introduction to some very, very different characters that
Absolutely.
We haven't seen before.
I mean, this is a great introduction to Doctor Strange. It certainly builds on the 1978 TV movie.
Absolutely.
And maybe is slightly more closer to the origin story. Mm. Again, it's another origin story. And I suppose it's one thing I've always said about the character of Doctor Strange is that actually I think you have to be really careful when looking at comics on Doctor Strange, because he does have a lot of retelling of the origin story. It is a really good origin story, but for fans of Doctor Strange, sometimes you kind of go, oh, not another origin story. And it's kind of like why Way of the Weird for me at the moment, the current Doctor Strange comic series that's not linked to the film, is really good because it isn't his origin. You know, it's the same with The Oath, with the Doctor's Out, all those different comics. They aren't origins. So, I mean, for me, I remember at the time, absolutely fantastic that, you know, finally we were getting Doctor Strange in a movie and in an animated movie. Mm-hmm. You know, this was long before I thought there was going to be an October release of a Doctor Strange movie in 2016. Right. So, this is a really good introduction. Yeah, it's got its issues, I think. But it's a good introduction to the story, and it builds on definitely the 1978 TV pilot and TV movie, obviously, and thankfully.
Certainly, yeah. One of the things we did say in our review of that was that the great thing about this was that it's going to be based in an animated world, so they're able to do a lot of stuff you can't do in live action or couldn't have done, definitely not in 1978 as a TV pilot. Chris, do you want to kick off and give us your first point about Doctor Strange, the animated movie?
Okay, guys, I'm going to start this off, and I know this... I'm typically... For new listeners and for our returning listeners, a bit of an explanation. I typically find some flaws where others may not. And
okay,
with this, and now I'm prefacing it in that I do enjoy this film as a whole, and I'll defend parts of it later. But as that origin story, they did really turn the Doctor into a whiny, before he becomes the Doctor, back when he's Stephen Strange, my God, he's whiny, and like, he's not that egotistical kind of schmarmy kind of Doctor that you get in the other kind of origins and retellings. In this, he's kind of like the, woe is me, life is terrible. And I think, John, you're right about the origins, is that we usually do get a lot of origin retellings. Like, there's only so many times I want to see Spider-Man get his powers on film.
Absolutely.
But with this, like, I think the only... It's a plus and a negative. So they changed his backstory to include this kind of tragic element of his sister, who in the comics is named Donna. In this is renamed April for some reason, which is a bit strange, but...
I just wonder if it's because she's wearing yellow and she looks like April O'Neil from The Turtles.
Could actually be it. Oh my God. Yeah, I didn't think
about
that.
I just thought it was that.
Yeah. But so they use this backstory. They use that part being the sister's, a tragic element of what's happening with the sister as a backstory that makes him, rather than be kind of egotistical and schwarmy, he becomes this cold-hearted... I know schwarmy, I like that word. he's more cold-hearted, and he doesn't care about the world, and money's his only thing, and fame.
Right.
And that doesn't translate for me, in terms of what the comic books were. He's still, even in the 1978 film that we just kind of walked through, he's schwarmy in that. He has that kind of je ne sais quoi that makes him, everyone love him at the same time as hating him.
Can I ask what shawarma is? I thought it was something you ate.
Yeah, no, that's a shawarma.
I think you meant smarmy.
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 Yeah, it's just, hey, look, I have an accent, okay?
It's shawarmy and smarmy.
Smarmy, yeah, shawarmy. Shawarma. It's all the same. it's like kind of that, the big headedness that I miss. Right. Like he's more emo, self-depressed.
Interesting you said that, because that was one of my points as well. The arrogance of Doctor Strange is much more present in this version, I thought, than in the 1978 one. What we saw in the 1978 one was some kind of lovable rogue, I think, is what I saw. It's a guy that, you know, he's sleeping around, but that's okay. It's the 70s. He's able to go and find himself a woman in any port, or, you know, pretty much everybody's in love with him everywhere around him. We don't see much of that with this Doctor Strange. There's definitely no love story that's being developed around him. This is much more a story of his history with his sister, that kind of thing. But he has some great moments of arrogance that I absolutely loved and were ripped straight from the comic books. I love that he's got his assistant who's running up behind him with all the cases, and he goes, would any of the medical journals be interested in this? No, well then neither am I. You know, that arrogance of him. The other one is that he's being shown the kids who are in comas, and he's being told, you know, that's been some kind of growths on her brain. The father says, and she was having nightmares too before she lapsed into this coma. And he goes, that's really bad for her, but I'm not a dream interpreter. You know, it's like he just doesn't want to be involved in anything unless there's money involved. So that part of the story I actually thought was a bit better told than the 78 version. And it strikes me as more so, more of Stephen Strange I know from the comic books.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't really think that 1978 that it was not a good version. It was just a different version, and the arrogance was lost. And I mean, increasingly that has become the central bit. And I think that, that they got the arrogance. I mean, I had kind of had this as one of my points, you know, that there was an element of the classical Doctor Strange origin story here, of which the arrogance, was part of it. And I think that was best told with Dr. Atwater in the hospital, you know, where he's going, money brings recognition and recognition keeps the people coming, which brings money.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and she goes as well, I'm sick of this hospital feeding your ego. There's a lot of stuff there. Even I think his boss ultimately says, you know, senior doctors wants to strangle each other. I can't run a hospital like this. And he kind of clarifies to say, they want to strangle you, Steve. Like, so you really get the sense that he is disliked.
Yeah.
And even with an old flame, Dr. Atwater, that she is at the end of her tether.
She pays for him to go to the other side of the world. She must really dislike him.
No, well, that was it. That was the strange thing why she did that. But obviously there was an old connection there, and obviously he was down and out at that time.
Oh,
so,
absolutely. No, I'm being facetious. I do understand.
So it's kind of like, I think they captured the arrogance, I thought, pretty well. And then, I suppose in terms of his relationship with his sister, like, that's in the comics as well. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I mean, it translates that, ultimately in that he loses his sister. So he disconnects from being effectively the kind of doctor that we saw in the 1978 TV pilot, which is one that is in a public hospital, is helpful and tries to do his best. And instead we see this arrogant, doctor, ultimately crashing and burning. Just expanding on that whole thing about, you know, this classical Doctor Strange, it did also have a few twists and different embellishments to it. It wasn't pure in that sense. You know you have that car crash that's been caused, and it's through him seeing visions of children and a direct influence of him seeing Dormammu.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, that's a slight twist there, and even the slight awareness that he has of his gift in seeing Wong and that creature that they're fighting at the start, where he is aware of them, you know, but he kind of shrugs all this off as not, maybe he's just tired from being a doctor and working long hours, or, you know, he just doesn't put any stock in that. So, like, there are a few twists, and I mean, as well, I think we do see a classical kind of Mordo, Baron Mordo here, who is, you know, straight off the bat, you know, is pretty unlikable as Absolutely. A character. And you can see that he thinks of himself as being king of the castle. And you know, he sees this usurper in Doctor Strange that he wants to kind of try and teach a lesson, put down, and really maintain his position or his rightful role as he sees it as Sorcerer Supreme. I mean, that's classical Karl Mordo, but actually it's a slight twist because it's right from the get-go that he is like that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the origin, he does, in a sense, befriend Doctor Strange. And I think we'll see this possibly in the movie in October. It's certainly been hinted at in a lot of sort of the reaction of the trailers that he seems to be helpful. And so I think with Mordo, you definitely get a more, once he does finally, you know, go after Stephen Strange, he is, it's definitely a more classical Mordo, but he's just too aloof from the outset.
John, actually, just on that, and this is something you're going to need to kind of, I don't know if this was a Steve Ditko, Stan Lee kind of idea, or if this came later, but Mordo and Strange are kind of, like, you have this two sides of one coin that they were both started at the same point. Both were kind of ego-driven type characters. Whereas when Strange went left and became more about the world, protection, etc., then, and that's where he focused his energy, Mordo then kind of went right and became very self-obsessed, more and more, greater and greater that level comes in. Is that something, or am I imagining this, or is there a play on that more and more? It's like...
I think it's absolutely that of two sides of the same coin. It's kind of that two-face element with regards to, two people who ultimately, one becomes the Sorcerer Supreme, one doesn't. But it's to do with how the cards play out as to the route they go. Because I think in the classic origin story, or it might be the Straczynski retelling, Mordo thinks he is going to be the Sorcerer Supreme. Absolutely. And that the Ancient One is teaching him to become the Sorcerer Supreme of Earth. And then Doctor Strange arrives, and it becomes apparent that he isn't the rightful heir to this title. And so effectively it's that jealousy. It's a bit like the schoolyard where, someone's getting more attention than another. And so, one of the kids goes off in a huff or something like that, but with adults and with magic. And it's, and so that's what turns him ultimately to, say the dark side, and he sells his soul to Dormammu to effectively in jealous rage to kill the Ancient One and destroy him, because he thought that the Sorcerer Supreme title and him, that was his.
Okay. Yeah. So that's an interesting, you have that dynamic a lot in the comic books. You have it a lot. We've yet to see it the MCU continues on down with the elements of this. This will probably be the first time we see that, where you have that dual character driven type story.
Hmm. It's interesting. Yeah. I think it's kind of similar to what they tried to do with Loki and with Thor, possibly, where the two of them are the sons of heirs to the throne, and then Thor gets the throne. It's similar in a way to that. But I have to say, in this particular film, one of my points was about Mordo and the Ancient One's conversation, because I thought it was really well handled, where the Ancient One stands up to Mordo and says, if you thought that you were supposed to be the Sorcerer Supreme, that was never on the cards, and your actions recently are the things that are justifying why you would never get this title. You can definitely see that Mordo's been the leader of this group of the Masters of the Mystic Arts for what looks like years, protecting the Sanctum Sanctorum, making sure that the Ancient One doesn't get killed and the Sanctum overrun. So he obviously feels, I'm the general of this army. So what's higher than the general? The president? So
field marshal.
Something like that, the field marshal. So when the field marshal dies, I'll become the leader. But he's told you will not get this job. You will maintain your position as trainer and leader of the Masters of the Mystic Arts, but you'll never become the Sorcerer Supreme. I thought that was really well handled in this story, and did so show the other story that was being told here, which is Mordo's rise to evil as Doctor Strange becomes the Sorcerer Supreme. I thought that was really well done.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, Mordo himself, as you said, Chris, he is arrogant. In this movie, his arrogance is shown by, the death of, the two ladies putting up the spell. I don't know their names, as they're sort of fighting. I think it's the Shinu, the two big kind of multi-teethed, monsters that they go to destroy, but he disobeys the Ancient One's orders. So, there's that recklessness as well.
Yeah, totally agree, John. Chris, do you want to give us your next point?
Sure. The visual kind of animation, it is very skillfully drawn, and I have a soft spot for this style, in that they also use it for the Ultimates and the Ultimates 2. In this Marvel animation.
Yeah.
Now, they're all different universe, but I have a soft spot for that kind of animation. While the fight scenes are impeccably drawn, I kind of miss that, I don't know, that kind of psychedelic Steve Ditko 1960s crazy kind of multicolored like what we got in like the 1978 film. Okay. I don't know why, but I feel some of that kind of astral plane craziness, that's where I thought it would take some of it, but it seems to be a much more grounded, almost like Batman the Dark Knight. Kind of, this is set in this universe, so it's not going to be too over the top.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah. I can see what you mean. You easily would expect that as animation, they could take it a lot further as well.
Yeah, it was kind of weird in that, I agree, I love this animation. It's kind of one of my points as well. I love the kind of manga-esque style of it, and when you see the credits, you realize it, you know, a lot of the work has been done in Southeast Asia. So I really like that kind of look of it. And I agree. I thought the best part where they really let go with all that psychedelic was the Nexus, where they kind of went to the Nexus where all the different realms come together. Mm. And it was showing the seal of Vishanti protecting all the other realms from the dark dimension, from Dormammu's power. Mm-hmm. And that's where I thought it really was lovely animation. I thought it was really nice. And I felt it was a shame that when all these monsters, like the two big beasts right at the opening, the Shinu, all these different beasts that came to attack Earth, it was a shame they put them in a tornado, basically, rather than some kind of really colorful, psychedelic, mystical kind of thing where the humans didn't see, because it didn't quite make sense to me in the opening, where Wong kind of says, right, I'm going to cloak us, hide everything that's going on. But if they're on a different realm and so on, then they were on the Earth.
Yeah.
So,
but the monster was cloaked itself. Could you see that? And that's one of the things. Like, he just quickly used the eye and then they can all see him.
Yeah. And then we must cloak our activities, and they create a tornado that then takes out a truck and a car and cause absolute devastation. When I feel like I think it was just, maybe they just didn't know what to do. And that was how they thought they would describe the explanation as to humans. Well, they just saw a tornado ripping through New York City, whereas in fact it was all this magical, mystical energy and battles going on in that storm. But I would have loved if they had done more with that person.
Exactly. For me, like, I was expecting when they did those shifts that, like, you would get that kind of shimmer, and maybe it would be like looking through a bubble. You get the prism style kind of effect where you kind of see the breaking of all the colors, and that would bring, even that what would bring in kind of the more of that, because I agree with you. I was expecting more as I rewatched this thing probably for the 10th time, because it's one of the ones I do go back to. I watch all these kind of animated, both DC and Marvel. They're great for nighttime watching, but you do kind of then kind of go, well, yeah, why did that? Why did you do? So I was actually watching one of the featurettes on the DVD, and they said that they wanted to ground the magic, and that's why some of these other disciples like use ribbon and a stick and earth,
right?
Because they wanted to make it less Steve Ditko, let's jump in and make it more about tapping into your chi and all that. They wanted to make it more kind of grounded, which I think does make sense. Especially when you start looking at these kind of like the Ultimate Universe was coming out in the Marvel comics about around then. So they were kind of trying to make all these grounded films, comic books as well, sorry. But I think that takes away from a bit of Doctor Strange. I think Doctor Strange is that he is the main connection to the realms of magic, etc.
Yeah.
In Marvel. Yeah. And I think He's a more cerebral character, and that's what you expect. When you walk into the Sanctum, you get a visual cue on the Sanctum. You see him kind of levitating with cross-legged, with a kind of floating book in front of him. And kind of then, like, he then passes to the astral plane.
I totally see what you mean. I think that they could have ramped it up maybe from the start of the film, having a bit more towards the end. I can see the impetus here for a character that wasn't very well known at the time. I don't think he had an active comic book actually in 2007. I think he had played a part in some other stories, but he didn't have his own series in 2007, I think. So you'd be trying to introduce people to a character they wouldn't have known very well. Unlike someone like Hulk, when they had Planet Hulk coming out, everybody knew Hulk. And the Ultimates, they're formed around characters that you know from Marvel anyway. So I think the idea here to ground it is similar to what they're doing in the films, right now. And I think we're probably going to see a lot of what we're seeing in this film. We're probably going to see a lot of this style in the new film. But I do think they're going to push it much further in terms of what they're going to do from CGI and what they're going to do from special effects in the movie than they did in the animated, movie. So, but interesting to know they were trying to ground it.
Yeah. I think the slightly different tack that's really going to happen from what it seems to be, being described and how it looks on the teaser trailer is that, okay, everything's going inception-y and there's all this, psychedelic colors and there's all these incantations and spells going on, but the average punter has no idea that this is happening. So things are being destroyed and chaos is going on here, mm-hmm. there and everywhere on different, planes, astral planes, but, you know, people are still walking down the street drinking their Starbucks coffee.
Yeah.
Like, whereas here, it was like they were trying to hide something that they didn't need to hide, ultimately.
Right.
But I think for me as well, just quickly back on the animation, because it was one of my points as well. The other two aspects that I really, really enjoyed was I loved the drawings of the children, and certainly when they were possessed, I just thought they were really, really good, really creepy. And of course, you know, scary children, is always good. You've got to love them.
Uh-huh.
You know, freaky, weird ass kids, possessed, by my command type of thing. It is fantastic.
Always. Very children of the corn, yeah.
Yeah. Always a winner for me. Children of the corn type stuff or, Village of the Damned, mm-hmm. Midwich Cookies. Brilliant. And then, I love the poor dude being flushed down the sewers right at the start. I love that, where he's getting dragged back along the sewers by one of the beasts and just all the water spraying up and his face. That, to me, just reminded me of my childhood animation stuff, like on Ulysses, Cities of Gold,
good.
And all this kind of stuff. Really good looking animation there.
Yeah.
I don't think it was consistent all the way through by any stretch, but I thought there were moments where the animation really let go and was really, really good. Even Absolutely. With Dormammu, I didn't really like his horn aspect. I thought I preferred the more classical look of Dormammu, okay. but I thought he was still done really, really well.
Mm.
And I thought that was, absolutely fantastic.
Mm. Dormammu really reminded me of the Balrog from Lord of the Rings.
I think that was why, because of the horns, it felt Balrog-y to me.
It really did. Overall, liked the animation, but yeah, I would love them to have gone further, definitely. Kind of brings me on to my next point. Slight negative for me. I'm going to just call this the nameless ones, because we had the nameless one in our 78 episode and we all knew it was Dormammu. In this, the nameless ones, I just don't understand why we couldn't have had a character name for anybody other than the main six or so members of the cast. So many characters in here that I want to know just that, did they have an origin in the comic book? Where did they appear in a series sometime in the 70s and they're bringing them back as the Masters of the Mystic Arts here? Are we supposed to know who they are by their style or by the weapon that they choose or something like that? I'd love to just know, you know, one character's name other than Mordo and Wong and Steven. The amount of these people that look really interesting. Now, obviously later on in the movie, you realize the reason they're not telling you their names is because they're killing them all. But I do think this would have made a great pilot for an animated series. And you would have kept those characters around. But it really, I really struggled with it, throughout the time. I kept kind of asking myself, why aren't they telling us who these characters are?
Yeah.
They've obviously all worked together for years. Surely they'd call out a name here and there.
But they did. And, but the thing is, it wasn't enough that you kind of didn't get the introduction to this team, this mystical sort of A team that was being led by Mordo and Wong. I mean, I caught Lucy, I caught Regina, I think. I caught Adina, and I think Nero or Miro.
Right.
But it wasn't very clear. It wasn't, you kind of weren't introduced to these people.
Yeah.
And the thing is that if you had have been, because most of them, if not all of them, died, you would have really felt something. But because you didn't really know their names, then it didn't really matter too much.
Yeah.
There was the Irish guy with the magical snakes.
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah, there was the guy with the pole sending the tree up to kill those, the wing mog. But, like, all these deaths, and yet you didn't really know what their name was.
Yeah.
And you weren't introduced to them. So you kind of went, well, okay, then.
I found myself more often going, oh, there's the guy with that power that he's able to put a shield around himself for the red shield. Okay, and do I know anybody in the comic books that has a red shield around them? Who's that? I found myself questioning if I knew the character more than actually focusing on what the character was doing. So I felt there was a little bit of a drawback for me for this particular film.
The other thing to remember about this is we are not the target audience for this film.
Mm-hmm.
Like, these films were created as a way to bring the Gen Z generation into Marvel before the Marvel kind of full MCU kicked off in the way that we would know it now when we talk about it now.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, this was a way to bring kids, get them interested in Doctor Strange, get them interested in Captain America and the Avengers back then as the Ultimates, get them interested in the Hulk, who was going through a dip because of the other films.
And I totally agree with you, Chris. But I actually think that adds to why it's such a big drawback for me. The character that I'm going to call Lucy, because I think that's the one time they say her name, who uses the silk to take down one of the monsters. She wraps it around his legs and pulls him off the wall. I'd love to know who that character was, because I want to know more about her. But I have no idea who that is. And I'm assuming that kids that watched it back in 2007 would have had the same feeling. If they enjoyed that character and they want to explore more of her in the comic books, well, you try and find a name, even on the internet now, of who that character was. I don't know whether it was Nika Minoru, who's in the Doctor Strange prequel comic. There's just no connection at all. And the name isn't said. There's no name given in the credits or anything like that. So I think it's actually a bigger drawback if you don't call out some names of characters that people, that kids might want to go out to the comic book shop and pick up a comic that has that character in there.
Yeah, okay, I'll actually agree with you on that then. Not yet. Yeah. When you look at it from that perspective, yes.
Yeah, I'm assuming some of our listeners actually probably know exactly who these characters are. They probably know them better than we do. I've seen this movie a few times. I know John has, and Chris, you said you've watched it quite a few times as well. But I definitely couldn't find anything about these characters. I was searching for it on the internet quite a bit afterwards to find out, and I couldn't find any of them. So, but that's my one big drawback, actually. That's my only big drawback, really, for the film. John, do you want to give us your next point?
Yeah, I really enjoyed having, and I know Chris has alluded to this, I really enjoyed seeing his sister, April. I love seeing Stephen and his sister, because actually, like, it's an additional thing to the TV pilot. It, obviously, as Chris said, April is actually Donna in the comics. Stephen also has a brother called Victor. I mean, they've played some really important kind of parts in his own story. I think Victor being encanted back to life through the Book of the Dead.
Ooh.
And becoming a vampire, basically.
What?
All the vampiric verses and so on. So, like, I really like the fact that his sister was there, because I think his sister is so central to the sense that Dr. Stephen Strange is an isolated character, both when he's human and as Sorcerer Supreme, primarily because of before he becomes Sorcerer Supreme, he's isolated because of his arrogance. And this all kind of comes from the fact that he couldn't save his sister in this movie.
Yeah.
You know, I think in the comics, she drowns. And he can't. That's what sort of knocks him off from being a kinder doctor, I suppose, right. Rather than really sort of being focused on bringing in money and just being a well-paid surgeon.
I like that change here, I must say. I like the idea that he's training so hard to get to become the best possible surgeon so that he could save his sister, and then he doesn't save her. So he kind of doesn't know what to do with those skills now.
No, he knows
he can make money out of them. He knows that he's the best in the field because he needed to be to try and save his sister, who turns out to be unsavable. But I like that change. I think that's a really good idea.
And of course, then when he does become Sorcerer Supreme, he is slightly isolated then, not by arrogance so much, but more just the fact that he's actually in other realms and away from people.
Mm-hmm.
So I really like that. And I think here as well, I really loved, how it linked in with that love, loss, pain, conversation that he has with the Ancient One, you know, where the Ancient One goes, "You're a savior, but not all lives are destined to be saved." Like, he couldn't do anything about his sister, and it's the same even as being such an immensely powerful Sorcerer Supreme. Not everyone can be saved, but with his powers.
Yeah.
He isn't all powerful in many respects. People will still die, or he can't get to everyone. And I think just within the film, his sister's story and him, you know, his obsession with finding a cure for his sister, it just mirrors and repeats Stephen's own obsession with finding a cure for his own injuries to his hands. So I thought that was a nice little touch as well.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So Chris, what's your next point?
So I'm going to do a nice little ditty to start off how my point goes. And everyone was kung fu fighting. Oh, that was actually supposed to go, yeah! Okay, so actually, most surprisingly, which what I wasn't expecting, kind of thinking back on it now, is the effectiveness of the action sequences.
Right.
Like, if you were to translate those into real life kind of...
Live action,
there's the word. They really are beautifully choreographed. Mm-hmm. And the fights have meaning because you have death.
Right.
And you know what I mean? So, like, they're really well choreographed, but when people get hurt, they get hurt and then they die. And I think that's something you don't usually see. Anyone who dies in a comic book usually isn't dead. So,
but
they actually are to a degree. And it adds a greater depth. The audience of this is a kid's film, but there's a more... there's an adult element to this where you can probably see where someone did watch Kung Fu, the series on TV when they were growing up, and they added that sorrow and pain to the fight sequences.
Mm-hmm.
And then kind of said, no, we're not going to make this where everyone just gets a little cut and ends up all bandaged and kind of back in the original, back in Tibet. They die.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, there's one battle where they lose four people, straight away. That's the one where the Ancient One has told Mordo what he needs to do, and Mordo doesn't follow his orders. So they lose four individuals, friends, as the Ancient One tells them. It would be great if we knew the names, which is my point earlier on, obviously.
Yeah.
Because then they could also be almost friends of ourselves, I suppose. But I totally get you, Chris. I think that's the cool thing about it is everybody's got their own unique ability and everybody's got their own unique power, it seems. So that does make the fights a bit more dynamic. I absolutely love the battle between the Masters of the Mystic Arts and the Wolves.
Yeah.
I think that's a cool
little... Oh, that's superb.
Really stylishly done.
Yeah.
Really cool.
Like, that's one of my points is the battles with the creatures. I actually really like all of them, to be honest, for different reasons. I think the Shadow Hounds are just really well done. It reminds me of Attack the Block, the big black beasts there, or vice versa, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Thought that was really cool. And I suppose, to be honest, as you say, even though I've just said, because you didn't know the names, you didn't care about them, that's not entirely true. What I mean is that could be the case, maybe, for some people. But I think for me, it was partly the case, but then just the deaths just kept racking up, and you're like going, oh my goodness. And basically, it's only Wong and Stephen Strange that come out alive. I mean, the Ancient One is nobbled. All the Mordo is taken by Dormammu. Mm-hmm. Even Dormammu doesn't survive. Well, only temporarily, no doubt. And, you know, everyone gets killed.
Yeah.
Except those two. And absolutely. That is really, actually, I was going to say, refreshing for an animated movie. It's really good. I love the wing mark as well. I love the fact that that was, to me, I'm trying to think of the cartoon that I watched. It must be Ulysses, actually. But just the way they flew past and swirled round and then there was a skeleton there. Loved that.
Cool.
I just thought it was so good. It really reminded me of like
Piranha 3D.
80, yeah, it was Piranha. It really reminded me of, you know, 80s, early 90s animation, and in a good way. I mean, it was just really well done with the wing mog. But yeah, all of the battles were brutal. I think the best one was with the Shadow Hounds, mm-hmm. though, definitely. That was the most stylistic with the light and all that. I thought that was really, really cool.
It makes me wonder how they're going to translate it into the upcoming All Roads Lead to Strange film. In that, are we almost going to get a Matrix-style kung fu movie? You remember that scene with Neo and...
Oh, do I remember that scene? Yeah, that's burnt into my brain.
Yeah, but like, are we going to get that, or are we going to get this more, what I kind of perceive as a more superior kind of fight style, in that they use magic, but they create magic weapons. Like, that's what I would love to see. Almost like these spiritual weapons are created, because then you can have a lot more fun.
It was a very interesting choice in this film to have that idea of pulling weapons out of thin air and using actual swords versus actual swords. Yeah. I'm not sure whether that's going to be something they're going to do in the upcoming film from Scott Derrickson. I don't know whether that's what they're going to do. I think it is going to be battles of magic versus magic. The kind of things that we've seen, magic versus shields, that kind of thing. I'm not sure whether we're going to see actual weapons being created out of thin air.
Because you can imagine that could be like will against will. My will keeps my sword here while yours falters. And that could be like, I can imagine that with Benedict kind of like pressing his sword against his enemy, kind of like fighting and they're fighting on the astral plane with wills, where they're fighting on the physical plane with kind of like the swords of magic and air. And
I think I can still see that kind of thing happening. I'm just not too sure whether they're going to shape them into metal swords like the way they do in this animated film. I think we'll see it as magic pushing against magic, kind of like, you know, the force in Star Wars pushing against each other. You know, that kind of concept, I think.
Yeah, and as well, I mean, they do have weapons as well. You know, it's not just books and the Eye of Agamotto. There is the axe of Angaramus, I think is how you pronounce it. Like, it's in the current Marvel, Lego Marvel.
Right.
The all new Doctor Strange. So the all new Doctor Strange is walking around with an axe, and I presume that's the axe of Angaramus.
Right.
Or Angaramus or something like that.
Are they the ones that Mordo gets out of the air in the battle with Doctor Strange?
It could have been. So he definitely has those kind of weapons, so it'd be interesting to see how they're formed, definitely in the film. But yeah, I loved it as well, them just forming out these weapons out of the air, and, you know, the Ancient One saying he perceived it to be a threat, so it was.
Yeah, mm-hmm. like...
That was great.
It's a concern I do have when every MCU film up to pretty much to date has a physical fisticuffs, weapons, guns element. And this would be, if they were smart, this could be a way to still imbue that kind of, keep it quite centered. Yeah. While if you're going to be like shooting, it's one of the things like Superman with his like laser vision, It is called Laser Vision on Superman. This is how bad I am with DC, guys. Really? Damn. You know, with Batman, with his throwy things.
It's heat rays.
Laser vision as well.
And laser vision.
That's kind of like, you literally have mutants. It's almost that if you style, where you're going to have guys like shooting fire from their hands.
Mm.
We haven't really had that yet. No. And I think that's where they're going to have to set up some. I think this is going to be the first step. It's going to be a hard first step. We're then going to kind of go, okay, suspend disbelief.
Yeah.
We're going to have guys chanting, muttering, and then doing things with their hands, and then, like, firing fireballs.
Mm-hmm. And that's what makes me really excited about this. There's a real opportunity here to do something brand new in the Marvel Universe, and something that we haven't seen in cinema for quite a while as well. So I'm really excited to see how they overcome that challenge. I hope they don't, personally, totally my opinion, obviously, I hope they don't fall back on a trope, to use a word, where they try and make it like the other films for that reason. These guys are magical. They work in different realms. They should be able to battle against each other like no other person can, you know?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I think that's a really interesting thing, but it was a great thing within the animation. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can bring this, a lot of it, and ask how are they going to do that in the fourth up and coming movie? But certainly, like, the Shields of Seraphim scene right at the end of the second teaser trailer looks really visceral, even though it seems to be like magical shields up against a magical sort of wave or something. One of the other things I would say is, like, you get a lot of the evil creatures here being unleashed onto the Earth. The Shadow Hands, the Shinu, the Wing Mog, and the two creatures right at the start, at the opening.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, you know, I don't want to talk about the movie coming up too much, but to what extent are those kind of creatures going to even exist to begin with in the Doctor Strange movie? Or is it just going to be human protagonists?
Right.
Yeah.
You know, I presume it will be. But, you know, I think one of the great things about this here, except for maybe Dormammu, of course. But one of the great things about the animated film is that you have all these creatures. It is a different element, you know, that comes in, having all these different evil creatures being unleashed by Dormammu.
Yeah, I don't mean to go back to it again, but there is one of the creatures really did remind me of the creature that's left on Earth after Thor of the Dark World, the one that the big kind of doggy looking creature
my God.
With gigantic teeth. Yeah. So I think there is a bit of a connection here with the Thor universe, that I think they're setting up some of those creatures.
Yeah, you know, maybe.
Possibly there is that's who finds that creature, is Doctor Strange going to London to find that creature from Thor the Dark World.
But you, in fairness, know. As long as they don't do it that badly, the end of that where it was hopping off into the sunset across London, mm-hmm. I mean, what? Well, maybe
instantly on the other side of that wall, there's Doctor Strange cutting it in half. And sending it back to
and
the
then sending agents of cool S.H.I.E.L.D. with hoovers and dusters to go. I mean, oh my goodness. Absolutely. Anyway, Derek, what's your next point?
I think it's my final point. It's about the Ancient One. I love how he's handled in this. This is it's a pretty good role. It's a pretty standard role, I suppose, something that we would have seen in things like Karate Kid. You know, as you mentioned, Chris, Kung Fu. There's always the ancient leader who trains someone in the mystic arts. But I like his sense of humor. He's got a good sense of humor with Stephen. His instant one where he puts Stephen to work cleaning the floors. And Stephen goes, "Do you expect me to wash these?" And he goes, "Well, I'm too old to do it." And then he goes, "How am I going to use my hands with these brushes?" And he goes, "That's between you and the brushes," and walks off and leaves him behind. And he leaves him for what seems like about a month trying to break down a wall that doesn't exist. That's pretty harsh. You know, every single day Stephen is going out and he's giving him no guidance at all. But it feels like a bit of a sense of humor. But he does eventually change and help Stephen on the path to becoming the Sorcerer Supreme, which I really enjoyed. I liked the idea. He is supportive. He does realize that to overcome the challenges, you have to do it yourself. He's got some great lines in there about that motivational kind of a concept. And I do, I think if this was to continue, this wasn't a pilot for a TV show, if it was the pilot for a TV show and it was going to continue into a show, you'd miss the presence of the Ancient One. He does feel like a really good, kind of grounding and guiding hand, within this universe. And that's a really good piece because the Ancient One did survive for quite a few issues in the comic books. He was around for quite a long time.
Oh, absolutely.
It wasn't that the mantle was passed over to Steven immediately and he became the Sorcerer Supreme and that was it. Nobody else was around. So I like how they developed him in here. I liked how they did him.
Yeah, definitely. I love this whole scrub on, scrub off thing. Uh-huh. You know, the wall dismantling and the bear sleeping room, which then got a gorgeous looking kind of jacuzzi bath.
Uh-huh.
I thought that was really, really cool. But, you know,
you just have to take down an entire castle to get that after
exactly.
One night.
Yeah. It's the hard challenges of the body for spiritual enlightenment. Mm-hmm. That's all you have to do. I thought that was really good. Yeah.
Yeah. Also loved the pushing the stone with no weight. I thought that was quite cool. really enjoyable.
Yeah, absolutely. I know you normally ask me questions, but the one question that I want to ask you two, guys is, because they kind of explain the magic here. He talks about matter as energy and sorcery is wielding the energy.
Yes.
And I know, Chris, you had kind of, talked about how it's the science behind, Thor. The movie is saying, you know, things that you would consider magic are actually are science to us, that kind of thing. Like, what did you think of explaining the magic? Do you think it's explaining the magic away, or do you think it's nice having that grounded element to it? I mean, a bit like you said previously, Chris, that, you know, they were trying to sort of pull that in anyway.
I'm hoping... I loved what they did with this because exactly what that is. Like, you're controlling energy. You're controlling matter as a whole. So that's where they make the weapons from. That's how the stone has no weight. The wall constantly reappears. And I think that's a good way of doing it. So if you're turning around now to the whole new audience coming soon and saying, hey, we're not going to scare you by introducing all this crazy mumbo jumbo. This is basically, you've seen it before with Thor. This is just a different element where Thor was technology. This is controlling matter. Like they have found a way to bend space-time to what they want to control. And I think that then gives some people, the audience, I think what they did here, the audience goes, okay, here's a thread for you to understand and pull yourself along, because without that then you're really suspending a lot of belief.
I'd agree. I think it's really well handled. It does, of course, remind me of the Star Wars kind of concept of the force that surrounds you and binds us together.
Absolutely.
And the force is a way of controlling that. Obviously Doctor Strange is around well before George Lucas was around.
It's all about the Midichlorians. Everything,
if they go down that
everything
route,
leads to the Midichlorians.
No, it doesn't, Chris. If they go down that route, I will scream.
Yes, but I do like how they described it in here. I like that concept of it's the chosen few or the lucky few of us that can do it. So again, it's pointing out that it's not everybody in the world. It's not something you can train everybody in the world. There has to be basic understanding, and you have to be a chosen one to be able to use that. Yeah.
But if they do, I will scream, and it may be a scream like Darth Vader at the end of Episode 3 in the cinema.
No. Something along those lines, yeah?
So, Chris, what's your final point?
So, it's actually my penultimate, and I'll try and kind of talk through them, and these are very much a kind of thought stream, so go with me on this. The adult themes, nature of the plot here is quite harsh. And I mean that if you kind of think about that, there's an on-screen suicide.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
The monsters, I don't like kind of a lot of films where monsters don't hurt people or kill people. You know, where like there's monsters tearing through the city. So it's one of the reasons a lot of people don't like Zack Snyder's suit, Man of Steel, because he destroyed Metropolis.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, but that's real. That brings an element to it. The tension created there is... So Well, still marketing this as a 12s, I believe this is a 12s. In a lot of the worlds where it's kind of teen, you've got the death of the sister, you've got the guy, you've got the doctor trying to commit suicide, you've got, you've got people like blood, you actually see blood, or animated blood. Like this created, a real high tension in a film where in a film style that you don't usually get that. And I think it's one of the reasons I think you guys like comic books as well, is that the comic book franchise or the world of the business world as well as the kind of cultural world that has been, it's not afraid to touch on subjects that political correctness or kind of the world we're in now don't like touching on. So this, you see Stephen Strange get so low after kind of literally getting to the hitting rock bottom that he tries to kill himself.
Yeah.
I don't say a Disney film or like, if it was any other type of kind of show, they wouldn't do that.
That's true.
Absolutely.
And yeah. it does feel like one of the really good DC animated films. I think it's well known out there, really, that DC do great jobs with their Batman animated films, with their Superman animated films, things that you wouldn't expect. If you don't read comic books and if you're not involved in the comic book world, you probably don't know that comic books are actually really, really deep. A lot of people tend to see, you know, the capes and cowls, and that's kind of it. And then they just ignore them and go, these are for kids. We're a lot older than kids. We're still reading them, and there's definitely things that happen in those books that that do touch on quite dangerous and quite difficult topics that people wouldn't expect them to. It's not just the villain of the week and punching someone in the face and that's the end of the story. It can be that too, and that's fun.
Yes, Sam Raimi.
but in this case, there's definitely some serious topics, and yeah, if a kid's not mature enough to watch this, I can see why it is marked as 12s as an animated film. It's not for general audiences. I can definitely see that. But yeah, there's some serious stuff tackled in here, and I like that as well.
Yeah, and it's like, actually, that's something I love. I use that word sparingly, but especially in 2016, where we are now, a lot of the bigger comic book names, such as your Iron Man, your Thor, your Captain America, are all touching on what I would call very tough topics, everything from gender bias to racism to you name it. Like back in, it would have been, I think, the 70s, correct me if I'm wrong, I know someone out there can probably better tell me, Green Arrows, now this is a spoiler, but like it's from like 40 years ago, so you could have, Speedy, to Green Arrow's sidekick, was found doing drugs, and they put it on the cover back when heroin was becoming a big deal.
Right.
And
right.
I think that's the piece that, while sometimes the art style is made for kids and it's like that the villain of the week, they still touch on these subjects. And I think that's why like there is these adult versions of comic books where you have like The Walking Dead and Invincible and Saga, and where we're growing up as an audience, and the writers and the industry is growing up with us.
Absolutely.
Like, it would not surprise me if they have an R-rated cut, 18s-rated cut of this animation film.
Right.
Like, the way they really kind of went a bit deeper and harsher. Because it is violent, and it's adult violent, and
He bankrupts himself as well, leading to him about to chuck himself off.
Off the bridge. That's the thing.
He does.
Yeah,
That's the bit that I went, like, if they had him on the bridge, you could probably pass it away to a kid as this is him kind of contemplating his life. But he full on jumps off and he flies, and like he was about to hit the water, and then Wong saves him, and I'm like, whew, that's a tough one.
Absolutely. Yeah, totally agree, Chris.
So, John, what's your next point?
It's just Dr. Atwater, but also Wong as well. I really like the fact that these two were kind of a support around Stephen Strange, even though he didn't know it at all. And I think I love the fact that this was kind of connected between the two of them, Dr. Atwater and Wong, where they kind of say and repeat the same thing to Dr. Strange. So, like, Dr. Atwater kind of goes, you know, you don't need your hands to continue to be a doctor, you know, when Stephen Strange is really at a low ebb, but it's just in the hospital room.
Yeah.
Stephen Strange really is being absolutely vicious and awful to her in this, where he you know, you think I had this coming to you, he says to Atwater, you know, and she's absolutely shocked at this. You know, he thinks absolutely the worst of his colleagues, just in the same way that, you know, he is arrogant. And I love the fact that, you know, she kind of echoes what Wong says later on by saying, you don't need your hands to continue to be a doctor. And again, when Stephen Strange is with Wong and he says, I'm a doctor, I need my hands, Wong says, no, you do not. And there are other ways to use them with purpose.
Mm-hmm.
But he goes, then there is no reason for me to be here. So it's like these two things echo between Atwater and Wong. And I kind of like that because you kind of have his, spiritual protector in Wong and his earthly protector with Atwater, who has obviously been doing maybe some of the healing after the crash.
Mm-hmm.
She gives him the money to go on this final sort of trip or last gasp effort to Tibet, which she didn't need to because, I mean, he's been an absolute arse.
Yeah.
So I really, really liked that. That she keeps her head above the water on this, and she doesn't descend to his kind of level. And I like that then, the connection between through telling Stephen that you can still help people without being this maniacal surgeon and this obsession with your hands being perfect. I like that.
Absolutely, and I like that he comes back to Atwood at the end and tells her, I have changed.
Yeah.
You know, it does show the progression of Stephen, and kind of says you'll see more in future. So again, we may have seen her in a future incarnation or a follow up film. Chris, what's your final point?
I don't like to do this, but I'm going to actually, for this time, just the way that our points kind of came up there. I did actually find flaws in this film. And it's actually just one flaw, and it stems from actually watching the 1978 version first, which is a weird one. But when we get to that middle section of the film, where Doctor Strange as a character, he doesn't seem awe-filled by magic.
Right.
You know, kind of in terms of how quickly he grasps the magic surging through his fingertips almost like. And when he's thrust later in the film into the stereotypical mold of being a hero,
mm-hmm.
he does it without resistance, without doubt, without like even question, really. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the one. It was trope. I got to say it in this episode. Yay! Score one on the Defenders TV podcast bingo. Like, when you just basically, as a storytelling device, you can just say that the hero accepts the role of being a hero. Whereas,
mm-hmm.
What I liked actually in the 1978 is he asks, why me? Why do I need to do this? Like, why can't I help being the doctor who I am? Why do you need me to work on this mystic level? And I suppose mm-hmm. that's just something that.
Yeah. There's definitely something missing, mm-hmm. I think, because he's suddenly, even just him tackling Dormammu after effectively seeing him once on a training ground with Mordo, and he's taking on like a immensely powerful dark magician in Dormammu from the dark dimension. Yeah, it's really weird to. It feels as though there's a piece missing. I definitely get you, Chris, in what you're saying. There's a piece missing, and it's that connection from him really starting his training to becoming this all-powerful, no-holds-bar Sorcerer Supreme, it feels like there's something being left out, whether it's just a scene or something. And I think it's even just the fact that he's so blasé about the psychic connections with the kids at the start and seeing some of these things. And he just rubs his eyes, or even walking into the temple in Tibet. And, well, hang on. The Ancient One's floating with his legs crossed. Yeah. Would that not absolutely send you bonkers?
I wonder if that's the animation style, because he does have a shocked look on his face when he sees that, but it doesn't look as shocked maybe as you would expect, I suppose. What I kind of got from it is that it felt like they were trying to tell too much in the time they had available. So we have the opening scenes where they're chasing down the creatures from another dimension. Then we have the kids in the hospital who are in a coma. And then we have about 40 minutes, I think, of Doctor Strange in training, which seems to last in real time. It lasts about 5 or 6 years, maybe. And then he goes back to New York and the kids are still in comas. And there's even more that have been added. Like, it feels like so much time has passed since he was in the hospital.
Yeah.
And then he goes back to try and save them from Dormammu. But it feels like those two pieces of the film aren't connected. Yeah. It feels like those should be two completely different films. One an origin story and another one when Dormammu attacks the world.
Absolutely. And there's also these four big creature battles as well that occur. Yeah. Which, you know, I was kind of watching it the second time. I was thinking, oh, the Wingmog is coming in next. And then it was like, oh no, there's the Shinnig. And then... that's quite a big chunk, and okay, it sets out the story that Mordo is pretty bad and he's gone against the Ancient One's wishes, but like, there's four huge battles that occur with evil creatures, which could have been pared down to two to allow a bit of space to maybe explore more of Doctor Strange, or to see him really grow. I think you just miss that kind of growth of him becoming the Sorcerer Supreme.
Yeah.
And okay, it's a film. It's only got so long.
Yeah.
But I think you kind of just miss that side of it a bit. You know, he's taken down the wall 1 minute where he's shown no magic. And the next thing he's beating Mordo and doing sword fights. Even that was a shock. And then for him to conjure up whatever spell it was that made him destroy Dormammu, I just kind of thought, wow, that is a steep learning curve.
Do you remember the line in the 1978 one where it's like, you have all this power, you're like a loaded weapon.
Yes, that was
the actual quote. It's like, you're basically a loaded weapon, but with no safety. And we need to train you how to use it.
You're like a child with a gun.
That was it. You're a child with a gun. Yeah. I think that would have been a more organic, healthy storytelling element to it, where they had have said they taught him all this thing and then basically went, look, you are still learning, and then he fires off the nuke that destroys Dormammu or sends him back, and then you would be able to say, okay, but you still need training now. Like, you got this amazing power and you're able to conjure these things that some of us can't even think about. You are a chosen one, but you still need to learn control. You need to be that hero. And when he just goes, I'm going to be a hero, I'm suddenly going to put on my cool coat, which is a cool coat, by the way.
It is a cool coat. It's no cloak of meditation.
No, but it's just, I think that's the thing. There was,
very cool.
John, you hit the nail on the head. There's probably expedited growth within the time amount that's trying to be told. And yes, it's a direct-to-DVD Blu-ray film. Like, they couldn't do 3 hours of animation. It would take them forever.
Yeah.
But I think it was just more, you could have done it with a few quick scenes, like 30 second scenes where, like, there's a reason 1980s film have montages to show the progress.
Yes, but at the rate the masters of the mystic arts are getting slaughtered, they really don't have time for it, don't they? Okay, we need you as a Sorcerer Supreme. Just go out there, wake up the kids, and that will send Dormammu back to his dark dimension. You don't have to do anything else. All you have to do is go into their dreams, wake them up, It'll be grand. Off we go again.
That's it. They're losing personnel to train.
Exactly. Exactly. I think we've gone pretty in depth into the animated movie of Doctor Strange. Anybody have any notes?
Oh, yeah.
I've got
one quick one.
Okay. My first one, because I haven't had a point in a little while. Did you notice the little shout out to Dr. Blake in the hospital? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, everybody got him. So Dr. Blake is the human persona of Thor, particularly the early versions of Thor, which had a hidden version of him on Earth, christened Dr. Blake. We do see the version walking through the hospital with his blonde hair, carrying his trademark walking stick. So quite a cool little moment. Again, they'd already done Thor in some of the other animated movies at the time. So nice little shout out there. And Chris, do you want to give us one of your notes?
Okay, I'm just going to do this one because it's an Easter egg, and I'm pretty sure we've all got it. The picture hanging on the wall in his office. Do you guys see this?
No.
Okay. In Strange's office, at the beginning of the film, there's a still from the 1978 film.
How did I know? See that?
I didn't spot that.
Go back, dude. Go, like, really. So it's literally someone told me this years ago, and it's ever since then. Your eyes are drawn to when he's like, there's something else going on, but just scan the background. It was a lovely nod. You gotta admit, it's like there's a still there from it.
Excellent, excellent. I definitely have to go and check that one out. John, do you have another note?
I do. I've got two. I love the water shaving that he did. That was really cool. And obviously then it leads into him being kitted out in the really cool black robes with the red design on it. That was really good.
Can I just say, when he tried to shave himself with his when his hands were already bundled up and stuff, that was the most nervous I've been watching an animated movie. I'm going, this guy's suicidal, and he's got a razor in his hands, which he can't really use. Is he going to be found by the doorman in his bathroom later on that night or something? But yeah,
like that. So yeah, I mean, that was really cool, I thought, the water shaving. And then again, I just think poor Clea, she's only mentioned right at the end, when they're obviously trying to rebuild the Masters of the Mystic Arts. It was, again, it was a nice little sort of sideways look from Doctor Strange. Very telling, very sexful, but definitely, I felt sorry that, again, Clea kind of not really in it, just kind of hovering around in the background. I think just one other point as well, it's interesting to see that there is this concept of a group of masters of the mystic arts in the same way that's been, shown in the Prelude comics, and what's obviously a basis for this film, that they're not all subservient to Doctor Strange as the Sorcerer Supreme or even the Ancient One. Yes, he's their leader, but they are all masters of this skill and the art of magic.
Yeah.
And I really like the fact that it echoes with that thread at the moment in the comics.
Mm-hmm. Any final notes, Chris?
Sure. Just actually one which I found, it's literally a note, is that it was nominated, and I think it won the Best Home Entertainment Production in 2007's for the 35th Annual Annie Awards, which are animation kind of film kind of awards.
Right.
And it just shows, like, while everyone knows and loves DC's, or everyone should know and love DC's animated plethora of films, which are fantastic. If you haven't watched them, do go.
There's some great
The
ones,
Marvel yeah. aren't half bad. There's some there's some in there that aren't the best, but some Marvel ones did win awards and kind of get nominated for animation awards and storytelling awards back in the day. So yeah, if you have a chance, go kind of check some of the other ones out.
Excellent, excellent.
And the other thing that I thought was quite cool, in the best Roland Emmerich style, the opening were, the ladies looking into the rearview mirror to see the tornado coming down the street, and obviously cars and buses and taxis flying everywhere. That to me was straight out of Day After Tomorrow, or 2012. You know, or Godzilla, big, yeah. Yeah, big Roland Emmerich disaster film. I really kind of liked that. I also liked the other look back in the wing mirror from the taxi driver who then got nibbled to death by those hungry critters, the wing dog.
Very cool. Very cool.
Poor dude.
On that note, Chris, do you defend Doctor Strange, the animated movie?
I do, guys. As I said, usually I would be more negative than most of you, and I can only find the only flaw I have is a kind of small storytelling one where it potentially could have been fixed or deleted scenes. As I said at the beginning, this is kind of a Grey's Anatomy, Batman Begins origin, and any magic fantasy kind of hack and slash action video game all boiled into one. It's a mystical adventure with that's perfect for in terms of an adaptation of the Marvel product, and it's perfect for new coming in Strange fans, if you're Marvel fans or lifelong fans like John. Like, it's still skillfully drawn animation, strong voice acting. It's a really good story, and that the battles are kind of pulse-pounding, and that there is death, there is an element of kind of realism there that you don't get in a lot of other kind of animated films. So I fully defend Doctor Strange, the Sorcerer Supreme.
Excellent, excellent. John, do you defend Doctor Strange, the animated movie?
I do. No, I do. Of course I do. I do defend Doctor Strange, Sorcerer Supreme, the animated movie. I would give this 3 Shadow Hounds out of 5. Right. I really like it, but it definitely has some storytelling issues. It has some, I think, structural issues with regards to the film from that point of view. But ultimately, you know, as far as I'm concerned, this was the best I was ever going to get until... Benedict Cumberbatch flicks on his cloak of levitation in October 2016. This was the best I was going to have. And to be honest, it introduces the world of Doctor Strange really neatly. The animation, for the most part, is actually really top-notch. I love the fact that, you know, it develops the Doctor Strange storyline by bringing in April. I think that is one of the more poignant parts of the animation. Mm-hmm. I love the fact that the animation doesn't hold back. You know, it does deal with the death of effectively the entire team, including the Ancient One, apart from Wong and Stephen Strange. And I mean, if only we had known their names, we could have mourned their loss even greater. You know, that's what that's really what pulls it back from me from being a 4. You know, I really do like it, and well, it's got a special place for me as an animated movie. But I think, you know, for this podcast, I would give it 3. Maybe I would nip it up to, you know, 3.5 Shadow Hounds out of 5. Given that some of the Shadow Hounds were sliced in half by Mordo, you know, there are a few half of them hanging around, but it's a really good animation. It's hard hitting. It deals with adult themes. Definitely, there's a lot of death for a cartoon, you know, it feels epic. It does feel epic. You know, the music score behind everything, which I hadn't mentioned, but, you know, it is pretty epic, to be honest. And some of the animation, when you go into the Nexus, when you have some of that kind of anime type light, style coming in, I think it is a really good Marvel animated movie. Derek, what about you? Do you defend this animated movie, Doctor Strange?
I think I just defend this movie. I think I'm a little bit colder on it than you guys. I've seen it a few times now, I have to say, so I'm not sure whether just the sheen has worn off a little bit of finally getting to see Doctor Strange in an animated film. Again, as John said, I thought this was the only thing I'd ever see of Doctor Strange. So maybe it's the fact that I'm looking forward to the movie coming up, and I'm really excited about it. I just see a lot of problems now. The ones that I mentioned earlier on are kind of overwhelming, where I'm going to go, and who's that character? Oh, I'm never going to find out. Who's that person? Never going to find out. Why are those kids left sitting in hospital in comas for 2.5 years while Doctor Strange goes off to the other side of the world? Should he not have sent, like, Mordo to go over, or Wong to go over and help out those kids when he realized there was a connection? There's just some issues of storytelling. There's some great scenes in it, though. I'm so glad I was able to see it. I'm so glad I've been able to see it a few times now. It is still a good film and still worth a watch if you haven't seen it. So yes, I do defend it. I did enjoy it. I'm not sure whether I would repeatedly watch it, and I'm looking forward to the new movie, so it hasn't taken anything away. There you go. That's my defense of Doctor Strange, the animated film. We do have a little bit of feedback, guys.
Ooh. I'm hungry. Give me feed.
So our piece of feedback this week comes from Ronaldo, who sent in an email to feedback@defenderstvpodcast.com. He says, "Hi, guys. I'm embracing the summer of Strange. I've rewatched the animated film and Doctor Strange 1978 and just wanted to throw in my thoughts. When I first saw it, I was impressed with the tone, and nothing has changed upon repeated viewings. Lionsgate do well to give the film some gravitas through the cinematic score, great voice acting, and well-written script. I do think, however, the animation itself lags a bit in the overall standard, and would have loved to have seen a more manga anime-style animation to complement everything else. The animation just reminded me of Saturday morning cartoons as a kid, and because of that, I felt out of place alongside the much more refined elements, as mentioned previously." Ronaldo says, "Steven's backstory with his sister was an interesting take on the Strange mythology, but I thought it worked well to give a sense of compassion for Steven and offset what we felt for him as an arrogant surgeon. Not sure if his sister originally had been part of his origin story." Just to answer that piece, John did mention earlier on his sister died in different circumstances in the comic books. Drowned, I believe.
Yes.
So something that Steven couldn't say, but he does drive a little piece. But we didn't find out about that until a lot later into Stephen Strange's history. It's somewhere in the late 80s, yes, they brought that in as part of the origin. So not part of the original origin, but kind of one of the other retellings of the origin story. Ronaldo goes on to say, "Love the other sorcerers, and no punches were pulled for them, as most met their fate in the film. A pity as some of them had really cool powers. I would have loved if they were fleshed out a bit more."
Yeah, I say good. Derek, he has the exact same point.
I think we agree. And finally, Ronaldo says, "Overall, a highly entertaining transition from comic book to small screen, and I remember when first watching it thinking how cool it would be if there actually were a live-action movie of Doctor Strange. Well, we live in a remarkable time and are lucky enough to see this happen. Can't wait for November. Keep up the great work, guys. Cheers, Ronaldo." Thank you so much, Ronaldo.
Yeah, thank you, Ronaldo, for that. Always appreciated.
Cheers, Ronaldo. Yep, I think you pretty much just covered all of our points as well.
Absolutely. Shortest podcast ever.
We could have just put him on first, guys. Come on. We do the feedback first, and then we can take...
We've waffled on for an hour and a half.
Absolutely. But thanks so much. If you want to send in your feedback to us, listeners, you can email us again at feedback@defenderstvpodcast.com, where you can also send your notification that you've uploaded a review on iTunes at defenderstvpodcast.com/iTunes. If you do leave us a review before Luke Cage is released on the 30th of September, we will be drawing you out of a hat to go into our Summer of Strange competition.
That rhymed.
Yeah, it did. Wasn't bad, huh? In the Summer of Strange competition, there is a Doctor Strange pop. There is a Doctor Strange cap with the seal of Ashanti on the front of it. There is the two issues of the prelude comic for Doctor Strange. And right now, there's also a digital code for the first 7 issues, isn't it? Of
Way of the Weird.
Way of the Weird. That's it. The current Doctor Strange series. So loads of stuff to win there. We hope you've been really enjoying our Doctor Strange coverage in our Summer of Strange. Chris, have you been enjoying it?
Because everything's strange. No, that's a terrible tagline.
It's been a strange summer, all right.
Absolutely. So guys, that's the final podcast in our Summer of Strange series, the lead up to the movie Doctor Strange coming out in October over this side of the world, and November the rest of the world. How do you think overall you guys are feeling about Doctor Strange?
I'm 50-50. I'm terrified that this is going to be the Batman v Superman Suicide Squad of Marvel, in that
fun.
No, in terms of it's going to be, we'll enjoy it and we'll find some great elements, but in terms of it's going to, could it be the one film that potentially starts the superhero fatigue critics again going down the path going, well, we've just introduced magic into this world, blah, blah, blah. And then your last place we were was like aliens. I'm worried that if they don't get the tonality right of this and some of the explanations, then we could see a turning on this universe, the Marvel roller coaster of fun that we've had over the past few years. So I think it's 50-50. Like, either this is going to be a Guardians of the Galaxy, where everyone thinks it's going to be terrible, or it's going to be bad. It's going to be like Iron Man 2.
It won't.
Iron Man 2 was still a good film.
Better not.
Like,
be.
I still enjoyed it. Yeah. It's just, it's not the best out there, like.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that's
Can I just say, I do think the presser will have their sights set on this one as being the first chink in the armor of Marvel. I think this is going to get a lot more scrutiny than it would if it had come from another studio or
all the Russo brothers.
Or didn't have 12 movies leading up to the one that might possibly fail. There will definitely be a lot of pressure on this film to deliver from the press, but I'm totally looking forward and really enjoyed the comic books I've read leading up to this piece. I've been reading, as I said, loads of stuff from Marvel Unlimited, the animated movie, the 1978 movie, our Marvel 101 discussion, our Doctor Strange 101 discussion, where we talked about some of the origins, some of the bad guys, and some of the big arcs for him. All that led me to be really excited about Doctor Strange.
The thing is, as well, I mean, look, if in this day and age, you can't go into a movie and not know what you to expect, then maybe it's all gone the wrong way. I mean, I will know, because I'm a Doctor Strange fan. But I mean, I do feel that, you know, a lot has been said. I still feel that this is very much under the radar. Mm-hmm. I don't feel a media loving like you've had with Captain America and Iron Man. And of course, they've got more films behind them. You know, at the start, it was difficult. At the end of the day, I think it would be unfair to say that Doctor Strange would have been the start of the rot if it's mediocre or bad, because I think you've had that with Iron Man 2, quite frankly. Age of Ultron really wasn't better than Batman v Superman, in my eyes. I think, you know, I don't think Marvel has this 100% track record that is being spun. I think it's hugely impressive and hugely successful. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But it isn't the hit after hit after hit. And if it is, you know, I mean, I don't expect Doctor Strange to make as much money as the Avengers.
Yeah.
Because it's his first outing.
Yeah.
You know, so we just have to see. But
I'm so glad
they're
taking the risks with the money that they have to make this film. Yeah.
They're going down a different direction. I mean, I'm just glad that it's not going to be a standalone character. I think just purely the fact of Thor being outside 177A Bleecker Street. No, but that integration Absolutely. Into the rest of the Marvel MCU is really important for
Absolutely.
The character. Because otherwise, then it certainly is a bigger target to say, we'll have a pop at this because he's not going to appear in anything else.
Yeah.
The fact that he is means something else. And just to follow on from Chris's 50-50, I am 100% excited for Doctor Strange.
Good stuff. Good stuff. Well, on that bombshell, I think it's time to close out Summer Strange. Been really fun covering a different type of show in between our Netflix coverage. Next up, on Tuesday, the 20th of September, we should have our Luke Cage 101 coverage. Just a little bit of background about Luke Cage. On the 30th of September, we've got Luke Cage. I was going to call him Luke Strange there. I've been having
Luke
a summer,
Skywalker?
I've been having a Summer Strange.
Or
way
Brian
too.
Michael Bendis.
There is an old school podcast joke right back to our first ever podcast where I couldn't stop saying Brian Michael Bendis. Anyway, no, Luke Cage begins on the 30th of September. We're really looking forward to covering all 13 episodes of that show. And hopefully the Doctor Strange fans will join us for that podcast while you're waiting for some new Marvel movie coverage.
Definitely.
Yeah, but thanks so much for joining us. It's been really, really, really enjoyable.
Keep it strange, folks. Thanks for listening.
See you in September. It's going to be sweet Christmas in September.
Awesome. Bye.
Bye.
John's second least favorite tag on a Marvel film. What do you think his least favorite is, Chris? Which of the Marvel tags do you think John hates more than that one?
Oh, I don't even know if I know.
I'll give you
Iron
a hint. Man with
it features Iron Man.
It is Iron Man.
It features Iron Man.
So is that the one where oh my god, what was the name of the film? It's where Tony Stark comes into the bar.
Okay. Nope, that's a very early one. It is where Tony Stark is telling his entire story of Iron Man 3 to Bruce Banner. And we find out that Bruce Banner is asleep and has been asleep the whole story. So that is the worst tag of all of them, according to John.
I don't know if I ever said it was the worst tag.
Yes, you did.
But the shawarma one and that one, they kind of weren't that funny. And I mean, yeah, I prefer my tags to actually kind of kick you off into the upcoming film next. It really gets you salivating for that film in the same way that the opening of a Bond really gets you excited for then the big musical intro and the rest of the film. You know, really kind of a big wham bam. The shawarma one and the Bruce Banner fast asleep, it didn't do anything. It could have been part of the film. So anyway, that's just my tuppence.
So speaking of kicking us off and getting us into the podcast, first thing we want to just talk about is we do have our Summer Strange competition going on at the moment. Send us an email afterwards with your location and your name to feedback@defenderstvpodcast.com and you'll be entered into the prize, John. Can they win?
Into the prize draw. Not the prize.
You can enter into John if you want.
We're going to wheel out a big toilet, ladies and gentlemen, and take a draw from that.
That's one of the reasons I am so enthralled by comic book universe and comic books. Because, so right now, well, as we record this, there's like the Iron Man universe and the comic books are going to be like, it's in the news that Iron Man is being replaced by...
Don't you spoil anything here, Chris. I'm cutting you off right there.
Okay. Let me think of a better way of saying it. It's in the news, though, but I'll think of a better way.
I don't read comic book news because they constantly spoil things in headlines. Now. Okay. That's the job of comic book news now.
Okay, that's literally how I found out. It's also in E! Network. Did we start for fresh then?